So this is my third guest for today on this wonderful, wonderful Ibethan Tuesday. Is somebody that I met at Space Again. He's another backroom buddy from the Space days, but that we, you know, we continue to remain friends since those days. And he's here to introduce himself.
Hi, Mark. Thanks for inviting me. Well, yeah, my name's Andy Wilson. I've been living in Ibiza now for this is my 22nd year. In fact, it's coming up this month, the 22nd anniversary. I'm best known here probably as a co-founder of Ibiza Sonica Radio, which we formed, myself and two Spanish partners formed 15 years ago. And before that, I worked on two other radio stations, helped launch one global radio and worked on another one. And before I came to Ibiza, I was a bit of a nomad, really traveled around with my wife and a lot in Asia. And I had a son in 98, which made us decide to kind of settle down, I suppose. And Ibiza was where we picked to come and do that.
Don't forget to go home.
Did you come subsequent times then, and did you come in your like kind of formative musical years?
Well, I didn't come back to Ibiza till 1989, by which point, at which point I was 24 or 23, something, or 25, in fact, because it was, I came for the closing parties. Which, so I was very lucky to get the last season where there was no roofs on the clubs. Yeah, wow. I think Coup was still Coup, and it was incredible open air, tropical feeling place.
So by this time, Andy, I mean, let's just go back a little bit further again, because you come from like you're from Manchester, and Manchester is a northern city. It's grey and cold, and you know, it kind of lends itself more to kind of the darker side of music, like the post-punk scene. And I know that you were a proficient player within the post-punk scene. Where was the change? How did that happen? How did you go from black clothes and Doc Martens to smiley t-shirts and flares? When did that happen? Was it one Sunday in Affleck's Palace?
Well,
today in Affleck's Palace, or how did it happen?
No, I never did the flares thing, mate. But you know, that was for the Teds. But it wasn't an overnight thing. I mean, I was in bands in the post-punk days from 1979. I joined a band, and then I left school when I was 16 to go professional and in a band with a record contract and a tour liner. That was a band called The Passage, which I was in for about 3 years. We did a few albums. And
yeah, they did some Peel sessions as well.
I did three Peel sessions with The Passage and one with another group. I did a few field sessions, and yeah, we had a following. We made a living in between signing on, you know. And then that kind of fizzled out about 83 or something, 84, by which time the Hacienda was already open, but it was playing, there was gigs there, you know.
Yeah.
And musically, it was a bit all over the place, but there was like interesting music coming out of America. I used to go to Legend in Manchester, which was where Greg Wilson used to play. And I mean, very exciting at the time. A lot of stuff that was coming out, and that evolved into the house scene. I remember hearing Jackmaster Funk, where Love Can't Turn Around, in 85, I think that came out.
That was probably the first one that I heard in a club situation as well, in Wakefield Pussycats. I can remember hearing that. And
yeah.
I'm thinking, what the hell's this?
Yeah, I mean,
and very quickly after that, Stacker, Humanoid, by Stacker, which is, I think, the year after or a similar year. And just because my own background is kind of punk rock and like post-punk and stuff, and it was those two tracks as well that I was like, what the hell's this, you know? And and there was the jazz guy, what's he called, Rocket,
Herbie Hancock,
that track Rocket.
Yeah,
I was like, what the hell is this? Arrived in Ibiza and you've decided to set up a radio station. What was the idea behind that one?
Well, I got very into radio and did some pirate radio in, because as a DJ, I started to DJ like about 1990 and just, you know, playing house music mostly when I played in clubs. But I was I have very broad musical taste, and I find it kind of a bit boring just to play the same type of music for very long. So that was a bit a bit difficult in club sets, because people just want to hear, they want to say, oh, this guy's he's playing handbag house, or he's playing techno, or whatever. And that I didn't really fit into any of those categories. I like to be able to do the Balearic thing, really, before I even thought of it as being Balearic. I didn't like to be kind of pigeonholed by a label. So radio is obviously much easier to play whatever you want, one after the other.
You're not having to make people dance.
No, exactly. So it wasn't the pressure of making people dance. There's so much music that I love that I wanted to share with people. So I love doing radio, and I got invited on a few pirate stations. I played Danny Rampton's a mate. He had me on his show on Radio 1. I've been on Radio Manchester. And I just got a buzz out of doing radio. My friend Johnny Lee, who moved over here at the same time as me, who I'd met originally in Koh Phangan, and Johnny had been traveling a lot, and he had this pirate radio concept, I suppose, called the Autonomous Zone. And he'd done it, he'd been up in Manali, and I'd done a pirate radio in Manali. We came over to Ibiza in 97, I think, and did it here. Yeah, did it here in 97 for a month. Didn't have a great range. It wasn't like we had thousands of listeners, but it was something,
And there weren't any licenses available then, were there?
No, there weren't. Me and Johnny had this idea. Because we both decided we were going to move over about a year before we did. So we started preparing for it. One of the things we did was go and do a radio course with the Radio Guild, which is run by a lot of ex-BBC or current BBC people. And they taught us a lot about, it was a lot of journalism side to it, like how to interview people, how to edit. In those days, it's still razor blades and tapes, a little bit of digital. And gave us a lot of confidence. And we also did a lot of research into European Union grants, community project. So we thought we had a plan. But when we got to Ibiza, I took a look around and realized actually there's a handful of powerful people run things over here. And the only way you're going to make anything happen is if you get to know some of them and get in with them. So Johnny carried on doing the pirate thing. But I, as kind of synchronicity, I guess, or luck, whatever, I met a guy who had the only English language radio show on the island, Brian Newman. He was also from Manchester, kind of fiercely working class guy. And he had been wanting to retire from doing this radio show, but he didn't want to go and let some, what he called the lovey-doveys from Santa Eulalia, take it over, because they were like the English community, the established expat or migrant, immigrant community. And he met me, he thought, this is the lad. So so I was just like thrown into the deep end and inherited a weekly radio show, just like that, on the main commercial station here.
And was all the stuff there then? And I presume you had to buy this the equipment off him, or
No, it was an established radio station. He just had a show on it.
Okay.
Which was called The English Show, or The English Program. So I changed the name after a few months, or a shit name, English Program, and started calling it Balearia. And I got support from the boss of the station, who used to laugh at me and used to take the piss out of me in Spanish. And even though, because at the time, I was learning my Spanish as I went along, but I was in the deep end working in a building with loads of Spanish people, Ibicenco people mostly, who were, and that was a great, very steep learning curve that put me in really good stead. And I had, two shows a week that were at 10 till 12 at night, I think, and I could play whatever I wanted.
Oh, and was that global, Andy?
This was Cadena Cien, which is a Spanish national station.
Yes.
But the boss, it's a franchise, Ibiza was a franchise. And when a couple of other guys came from other parts of Spain to work at the stations, Igor Marijuan and Miguel Angel. Igor was a DJ, a presenter, and Miguel was a comercial. His job was to sell advertising. They came and got work at Cadena Cien, and we hit it off through shared love of the same music. And we all started pushing at the boss, come on, we should start another station playing music for the people who go to clubs. No, because Cadena Cien was very much playlist dominated, and a lot of stuff from Madrid So that was how Global started out. Eventually, yeah, the boss was like, oh, go on then, let's do it. Because they had spare licenses. They had the, it was a media kind of, a local media conglomerate with a newspaper and a TV station.
Well, I remember when it all happened, you know, it was an exciting time because it, and, you know, I knew you, so that's probably how I got that it was an exciting thing, but I do remember it as being a big event.
Yeah, it was, to be honest, it was pretty much an overnight success because it was such an obvious gap in the market. There's a real demand for a good music station that concentrated on, you know, electronic music. It was very chilled during the day. At that time, what was called lounge music was quite a thing. And that worked really well in daytime programming. And then at night, we could get Carl Cox or Sven Bath or
everybody was up for doing it,
you know, Roger Sanchez, whatever, would not, you know, they'd love to come and play.
No, absolutely. It was really good.